Hello, Jeff Hansen here with Alta Labs, and today we are going to be setting up an IPsec VPN. So we're actually going to do both use cases of a server client situation, as well as a site-to-site situation. So two different kinds of deployments. There may be various reasons why you want to use IPsec. For example, the nice thing about IPsec is you don't have to install any VPN clients. There's no software to install. Pretty much all operating systems support IPsec IKEv2 out of the box. And so that is one thing that's very nice. A lot of times you won't get quite as good of speed, but that's okay usually because, you know, at least you can get it working and the compatibility is just a little bit better there. And so first off, we're going to start with the IPsec server. And so to do that, we have two sites here, A and B. And the important thing about IPsec and VPNs in general is you're gonna wanna make sure that at least one of the sides has a public IP address. Now, in general, it's best to have both sides always have a public IP address, but obviously that's not always possible in all scenarios. So, but in general, it's recommended to have all sides with a public IP. And in this case, you know, obviously you need at least one side to have one. So in the case that I'm testing right now today, our side A has a public IP address, and you can see that because if you look at our Route 10A, you can see on ETH4, it has an IP address here that is a public IP address on ETH3. It also has IPv6. So that's our side A. Our side B here, these are split up into two sites. So we can look at the information on this one. It's not a public IP address. It's a private one that I'm using here. So we're gonna go ahead and set up the server. So this is a situation where, you know, you have a lot of mobile clients, maybe people on their phones and laptops, and you set up a bunch of user accounts for each user so that they enter their username and password with their VPN configuration to get onto your corporate network. So to set this up, you go to the Route 10 configuration that you want to be the server, and you go ahead and you set up the IPsec server. So you just hit enable. You're going to want to copy and paste this Alta DIN DNS address. So this is automatically generated. Anytime you activate a Route 10, it's going to go ahead and register this host name with the IP address of your WAN interface. And so that way, instead of having to, you know, dynamically update your IP address every time it changes, you just have this static host name that automatically updates and always matches your WAN IP address, even if it changes. So I've already saved off that. Make sure it's enabled. You do have to select a subnet for your VPN. And so in this case, I've selected 10.6.0.1. You do have to make sure that it does not conflict with any of the subnets of your other VPNs, any of your other either site-to-site or any type of VPN. You need to make sure that it doesn't overlap, because if it does, you will not be able to route between those two subnets. So I've got that all set up and we're going to save that. So that's the first step, is to enable the IKEv2 server in Route 10. The next thing you need to do, and this is something that is tied to Wi-Fi as well as the VPN, every Route 10 can act as a radius server. And so to turn that on, you go to the Auth tab on the Route 10 and you hit enable. When you hit enable, it will, if you haven't already got a secret in here, it will automatically create one for you. And if you want to copy and paste that and use this Route 10 as a radius server for other services, whether that be Wi-Fi or anything else, you can actually do that. You just have to make sure that the secret is the same on both sides. In our case today, we are going to use this radius server as a VPN authentication server. So we're going to add a user. And you can use any password, even special characters. Work just fine with Route 10 VPN server. So all you need here is a username and a password that will be used on the other side for the VPN client. If you're using Alta APs, you can also specify a VLAN ID. So when they join the Wi-Fi, they will join using that VLAN if they use this username and password on a WPA EAP AP. And then also you can select a VPN IP. So if you want to give this specific client an IP address on the VPN, you can put that in here. So those are some cool features. So you can always have the same IPs or VLANs on those connections. Then you just hit save. Okay, so at this point, our server has been configured. And now I can go ahead and use any VPN client on any operating system to connect to this VPN server. Let's see, we'll make sure this is all saved and then go to the VPN tab. All you need to do is use this as the IKEv2 host name and then the username and password that we put in before. What I'm going to do today is actually use another Route10 as the VPN client. And so in order to do that, I am on side B. I'm going to open up the Route10 configuration on this side. And instead of a server, this is a client. So we're going to set up an IPsec client. We're going to call it to side A. And the host name is the one that I copied and pasted before. So we'll grab that, put that in there. In this case, you don't need a PSK because we are a simple mobile client. So we'll put in my username and password. Okay, and then you also need to put in the remote subnet that you want routed to the other side. And you do need to make sure that it ends in a basically zero, an empty subnet, at least that the last bits are zero, because if I put in 10.6.1.1, it'll be misconfigured. So you do need to make sure that you put in the correct subnets so that it will route that subnet, that class C, over to the other side. We can go over some of the other options. So there are a lot of options with IPsec servers and client site-to-site configuration because we interoperate with a lot of different VPN servers. So you may find that you need to use a specific option in order to be compatible with a certain server. If you're going to be a mobile client, typically you'll want to masquerade everything. And what that will do is any clients that are behind this Route10 as a client, it'll use the Route10's IP address as it masquerades to the VPN server. And so you can basically forward all the traffic for this new subnet to that other side automatically. Let's see. So now you can choose the version. So you can do V2 or V1. If you need to, for example, if you're behind a NAT or a firewall, we might need this for when we do the site-to-site configuration. Today, this very moment, we don't need to because we're doing just a normal mobile client configuration. So it's just going to use username and password. You can set the MTU if you need to. By default, I think it's 1412, so that's in there. We have a wide array of ciphers that can be used, and these are used for the key exchange and then the encryption of the actual data so that goes over the VPN. So we have a bunch of different AES ciphers, as well as the newer ChaCha20 Poly 1305, which this one actually allows you to get similar performance to WireGuard because that's the same cipher that actually WireGuard uses. And it doesn't require any hardware acceleration, but it's still very secure and very fast. Anyway, we're just going to leave these as the defaults. So PRF SHA-256. And these are not the highest security. It's kind of a balance. The defaults are a balance of speed and security. So it's definitely very secure, but it's not the highest options. It's not 521 bits ECP. It's not 512 SHA-512. Which take longer to generate and may slow down your VPN. So these are a good balance of security and speed. You can do how often the phase one lifetime is for Ike. You can change that. Usually you don't need to change these, but it depends on your VPN server. They may recommend that you use a different value there. And then we have the defaults here for the ESP cipher hash, Diffie-Hellman, and then the ESP lifetime. If you need to, some VPN servers may require you to set the remote traffic selector. So that is the subnet that you use on the other side. What this will do is take the remote subnet that you entered here and use that as the remote TS when it does the exchange, when it connects to the VPN server. When you're using Route10s, we don't differentiate there, so there's no need to turn that on. Local TS is very similar, except by default, it's wildcard everything. So if you do want to set it to a specific subnet, if you need to, for example, for some VPN servers, you can enter that here. And then we have the DPD delay and timeout, which are all documented here. So I'm going to go ahead and hit save. All I really needed to do was put in, make sure it's IPsec, give it a name, host name, username, password, and the subnet. And then if I hit save, I'm going to go into one of these clients here, and I'm hopefully going to ping the other side and get responses. Okay, here we go. So this subnet is the remote subnet that my VPN client that's running on my Route 10 is connected to. So you can see there that it's working. If you want to check status, we don't currently have a dashboard or anything like that, but you can open the debug terminal. So I'm hitting shift and clicking on the name of the device here to open up this terminal. And you just type IPsec status, and you can see that we have this VPN tunnel established between this Route 10 and the other Route 10. So there you go. So that's our first configuration, our first scenario that we wanted to cover, which is the username, password, mobile IKEv2 client. Now I'm going to go ahead and delete this configuration from both sides. And we are going to do a site-to-site configuration instead. So let's go ahead, and we don't need the radius server anymore. We don't need our user anymore. I'm gonna go ahead and turn those off. Our VPN server, we are going to turn off. So simple as that. Now it's not responding to any VPN connections. Okay, so now we're going to start over and try a site-to-site configuration between these two Route 10s. So to do that, once again, you just open up the configuration for the Route 10, go to the VPN tab, and hit plus on the client side. You want to make sure it's IPsec. We'll call this to side B. And the host name that you want to connect to, now, my other side, as I stated before, is behind a net. And so for the host name, you actually have to put the host name of the public IP address that router is going to be coming from. So I've already gotten that. It's another Route 10 in my case. I've already gotten that, and I'm going to paste that in here. So that's the host name that it's going to connect to from a public IP perspective. Now we need to set up a pre-shared key. If you want to just automatically generate one, you just click here, very easy. And then you don't need a username and password in this case because it's site to site. And then I happen to know that my subnet is 192.168.1.0/24. And I'm going to leave all of the other options as default. Actually, no, because this is a behind a NAT, I'm going to have to do this. So we actually need to put in our local ID, and that's the same ID that's right here. So you grab this local ID, you put that in as your local ID here, and then for the remote ID, you're going to get the remote ID of the other Route 10 and copy and paste that into here. Okay. And that's because I'm not using the same IP address. I'm not using the public IP address on the other side of the Route 10. It needs a way to negotiate, which keys to use, which PSK to use. And so that's how you tell us, by putting in the IDs here. I also, just so you know, had to put port forwarding on, UDP port forwarding on for port 500 and 4500 to this IP address here on this Route 10. And I did that previously. If you have both Route 10s on a public WAN IP address, you're not going to need to do that. But in my case, I had to do that because this one is behind another Route 10. So it is possible. You just have to set up the port for it. Okay, so this side should be good to go. Now we're going to set up the other side. So you open up the Route 10 on this side, create another S2S client. So this is IPsec to side A. And the host name of my other Route 10 is right here. I'm going to paste that in down here as well, since I'm going to need it. The remote ID is going to be that. And then my local ID is going to be this same DIN DNS right here. Okay. And then I'm not going to masquerade because this is a site to site. So I'm basically routing between these two subnets are fully routed between both sites. Now that does mean that you may not be able to communicate directly between Route 10 to Route 10, but the clients behind the routers will be able to route correctly using the Route 10s and the VPN connection. So keep that in mind. That's why I always test when I test a VPN connection. I test something that's behind the router and try to reach the other subnet instead of the router itself, because the router itself may not have the subnet set up correctly to actually be able to route. And usually you don't need the routers themselves to be able to communicate IP to each other. You just need your devices behind the routers to communicate with each other. So we're going to use the same subnet that we had in our first case, 10.6.1.0. And then our pre-shared key, let's go ahead and copy and paste that from here. So copy, paste. The pre-shared keys do need to be the same on both sides. And so I think with that, we should be good to go. I'm going to go ahead and hit save. And then once again, we're going to open up a debug terminal on a device that's behind this Route 10 and make sure that we can ping the other side. And yes, there we can. I'm also going to try the other side and just make sure that this is another AP that's on the remote side A. Make sure that I can ping a device. And yes, I can. So the AP can ping both the Route 10. This is the Route 10, on site B. This is the Route 10 on site B. And it can also ping devices behind that Route 10, so 1.12. On this side, I can ping, the AP that's on the other side. On site A, I can also ping the Route 10. But you'll see here that I'm going to try this real quick. I probably cannot ping between the Route 10s directly. As I stated before, but usually that's not necessary. So when you're testing it, just make sure that you test between the devices behind the Route 10 and not necessarily between the Route 10s themselves. Let's see, I think that about covers it. So if you have any questions or concerns or ideas for improvement, just let us know. You can reach out to us on our forum. That's forum.alta.inc. But otherwise, thank you very much for watching our video.